associate professor of biology at Massasoit Community College. She is the creator of Thinking is Power, an online resource that provides critical thinking education to the public, and she will describe some of her best practices in her talks. And please welcome Dr. Trecek-King.
Technique-based explains the techniques used to mislead, and can include the kind of experiential and what I'm going to talk about, so I'm going to leave that for now. We can also do it either before or after misinformation, so pre-bunking is before and debunking is after. And we also added the humor versus non-humorous, just because humor really works, right? It helps the medicine go down. So we try to use humor whenever possible. So, for example, what I'm going to do the rest of this talk is explain some of the inoculation activities that I do with my students to give you some of their reactions. I'm sure you're all familiar with Bertram Fohr's original experiment in which he proposed to his psychology class. I'm going to tell you how to do it with my students and then refer back. So, the very first day of class, I tell my students that I have a friend who is a psychic and she has agreed to give them free personality readings. And turns out I'm actually a really good liar. I give them this big ruse about like how great she is and so on. And then the next class, I give them their readings. I have them rate her accuracy on a scale of 1 to 5. And generally, it's about 4.2 to 4.5 out of 5. They almost all say she's very accurate. I don't know how she got me that well. And then I have them get in groups where they talk to each other about the readings. About the accuracy of readings. And of course, they know the opposite. Mm-hmm. So, in this way, the students are fooled, right? I fooled them for the purpose of teaching them a little humility and to be skeptical. Right? And I make a joke out of it, like, you know, I'm sorry I lied to you, but I did it for educational purposes and I didn't take your money. But I wanted my students to see the techniques that I used to mislead them. So these are known as for statements or barnum statements. These are statements which basically apply to all of us. But we also think that they uniquely apply to us, the foundation of astrology and horoscopes and so on. So we're calling this experiential inoculation, experiencing being misled. And then there's active inoculation, and this is by far my favorite technique. Active inoculation, in our definition, is when students create misinformation or are involved in the creation of misinformation. It's like learning how a wizard does his tricks to figure out what the wizard is doing to mislead, and actually becoming the wizard yourself. Right? Look behind the curtain, learn how to be the wizard, and then you learn the wizard's techniques, and you're not misled by the wizard. So I use lots of different inoculation activities in class, and the possibilities are really endless in my estimation, but I'm going to give you a few of the ones that I do. The first is, there's a couple of games. Cranky Uncle is from John Cook. I don't know if you were here for Sammy Yasmin's talk, but she talks about this game. It's wonderful. Cranky Uncle, you all know Cranky Uncle.
Yeah.
The guy at Thanksgiving, the climate change denier, you have to talk to. And my students all get who this character is. Cranky Uncle is a science denier, and he uses the techniques of science denier, which are summarized by the acronym FLIP. So, fake experts, logical fallacies, impossible expectations, cherry picking, and conspiracy theories. And in the game, Cranky Uncle uses those techniques. And the students figure it out in the game, and online quizzes is interactive. And as they do so, they make Cranky Uncle crankier and crankier, and they level up and then get to open up new techniques. And this game is wonderfully effective, and it's really fun to play as well. This example here, shows what's called parallel argumentation. So a lot of these science topics are really complicated, and you have to understand the science to really get it. But using something like parallel argumentation helps you see the techniques to mislead without needing to understand the complexity of science. So for example, the anecdote is cold outside, there's no climate change. It would be like saying, well, it's dark, so the sun doesn't exist. Right? It's a humorous way of creating a parallel argument that shows why that argument isn't a very good argument. There's also a bad news game. This is John Rosenbeek and Sandra Vanderlinden. And in this one, you pretend to be a fake news producer. And your goal is to build an empire of fake news. In order to do that, you learn these badges. So you learn conspiratorial techniques. And you learn emotional appeals, like rhetorical techniques, trolling, and so on. And as you do so, you level up and you build your empire. And you then, in the real world, can see these techniques being used in fake news or misinformation. So one semester, after spending all semester teaching my students how to think critically or at least I thought so, I would get emails from students, and they would say things about why they shouldn't fail the course, but the options that are needed to work. And I thought that was really ironic. So I had an idea for an assignment. And so in the assignment, have students pretend it's the end of the semester and you're failing, because you deserve to fail. But I want you to write me an email, and in the email, you use logical fallacies from class. So this is an example of one of them, and it was published in one of the papers. So the student says, for example, the reason my grades have been slipping is because my uncle's friend's kid's dog just had babies, and one of them got hit by a car, and now the kid is depressed, and I'm just really sad. Personally, a lot of grandmas and dogs die around the fire sign, right? So it's a pretty emotional email. But also, if you fail me, I won't get into graduate school, and then people will die. So that's a nice slippery slope. Yeah, I didn't do any of the work, but there are homeless people. Literally homeless people. We should hear about that. That's a nice red herring. Oh, and my mom and dad say that you're wrong too. That's an appeal to authority. The point is, they make these arguments using these fallacies, and then this is a discussion board. So they post them, and then other students have to look at these and pick out the fallacies. And so students learn how to argue illogically, hopefully then being able to see the fallacies in other arguments. I teach my students how to be a psychic. I teach them how to cold read. Now, I'm going to skip past this one relatively quickly because we've talked about psychics and so on, but I teach them the techniques and then teach them how to be psychics. I had one student say, once you see those techniques in cold reading, you can't unsee them.
Good job.
Right? I'm getting into these now. Right? But you can't unsee that. Okay. Have you heard of birds aren't real?
Yeah!
I love birds aren't real. Okay. So, for those of you who may not know, this conspiracy holds that in the 60s, the federal government killed all of the birds. And the birds today are drones. They power up by sitting on power lines. And they poop on your car to track you. And there's all kinds of other things, right? So it's a great example of people who are in this conspiracy theory are in it. They understand that they're a part of it. So with my students, I use this as an example. I teach them techniques of conspiracy theories, and then I have them make one. Make the most ridiculous conspiracy theory you can possibly think of. It doesn't matter. It just needs to be a consistent narrative. Go online, find evidence for it, these three pieces, and create a narrative of evidence. Professor, do I need to use reliable sources? No. Subreddit or a YouTube video, it doesn't matter, right? So just need to be convincing. And then I have them in groups with each other, and they try to convince others of their conspiracy while they try to convince them that their conspiracy is wrong. And one of the major characteristics of conspiracy theories is that they're unfalsifiable. And so their job is to maintain the conspiracy theory in the face of evidence that might disprove it. So, create conspiracy theories. I also teach them how to sell pseudoscience. I published this in the recent Skeptical Inquirer. This is an ad that I made to demonstrate the techniques. And I'm running out of time, so I'm going to go through relatively quickly. I will tell you that I've had people ask me if they could buy this. Okay, so things like unfalsifiable claims, or my favorite is technobabble, so like restores bioenergy frequencies. That doesn't say anything. I have to appeal to anecdotes and make it authoritative and make it vague, but really confident that you're right. Appeal to nature, always. Appeal to tradition, appeal to the masses, right? So key logical fallacy. Conspiratorial thinking is good too, so at the top, they don't want you to know about this. And then I have my students make ads. So here's an example. I give them options. So in this college class, the most popular supplements are things like weight loss, and muscle building, also penis enhancement. So it's a college class. I love my students. Anyway, so there's a nice before and so it's kind of the general idea of inoculation. This is a powerful tool to use in classrooms, in hopefully with the general public. And what we're trying to do is to keep people not to fall for misinformation. Inoculation theory hopefully will help us get there. I will say too, for educators, I always start with misinformation that's non-triggering. We can do funny things. We can do non-triggering things before we move to the stuff that's more triggering. And just to close, I would